across the nation, giant aircraft factories are working to build an air fleet second to none. We have pledged ourselves to this titanic job because we know that control of the air is essential to our defense. Defense of the air spaces above our homes and cities, and control of the air over military concentrations established by an enemy. The job of the interceptor and pursuit ship is to defend our own air theaters. The medium and long-range bombers provide power to strike at far-distant enemy concentrations. This is the projected defense technique which the RAF is employing with such success in Europe today. Our story of building a bomber begins in the foundry, where the men wear asbestos clothing for protection against the terrific heat from the pots. The molten metals are cooked until impurities rise to the surface. A chemical compound is then added, which smolders, finally catches fire, and burns the impurities away. This work requires a high degree of skill and stamina. Yet basically, it is not unlike operations which go on in your own kitchen. From the foundry come zinc dyes, lead punches, and castings, which are later used to shape the precision parts of the airplane. Here again, a fine art, centuries old, is employed to guarantee the utmost in precision workmanship. In the drop hammer forge, the lead punches and zinc dies are locked in the big hammers. Aluminum sheets from the rolling mills are placed on the dies, then the punches gentle the metal into shape and seal the shape with one final heavy blow. It is interesting to note that the drop hammer is one of the few machines which will press a sheet of metal into a reverse curve. Aircraft parts, most of them aluminum alloy, must arrive at the factory in a semi-soft condition so they can be worked without tearing. Later, they are treated in a chemical bath for hardening. The job of these great brakes is to bend and corrugate parts large and small. Note the delicacy with which these machines operate. A corrugated piece of metal has much greater strength than a flat piece. Here is the famous Yoder hammer in operation, a metal shaper long familiar to workers in American industry. This work requires a high degree of technical skill, too, since the operator must rely on the accuracy of his eyes and hands to form a perfect streamlined, curved surface. This moving drill press is a new development, an ingenious machine tool designed especially for American aircraft production. It is most efficient in the work of drilling wing spars, which are locked in place on a fixture. A steel template is locked over the aluminum spar, then the driller moves back and forth, drilling through the template into the spar. Semi-skilled workers can be trained to operate this machine in 3 weeks, yet the work is accurate to a thousandth of an inch. Another remarkable new development for high-speed production is the hanging drill basket, a shaped hard metal form which fits securely over curved surfaces and is locked into place. Rivet holes in this leading wing edge must be accurate, so they'll be exactly in place over corresponding holes in the wing ribs when riveters start sewing the parts together. Precision is the first law of the aircraft maker. Then comes high-speed operation and the development of special production machinery which guarantees quantity production. The secret of efficient assembly line operation is first, a simple, accurate operation for each man. Second, perfect timing so parts move steadily to final assembly. Flat and gently curved aircraft parts are stitched together by this high-speed riveter on which a tiny spotlight is synchronized with a spot pattern traced on the metal. Then the riveter stitches like a giant sewing machine. Rivets must be kept in ice boxes where they remain contracted and soft. To speed up production, many aircraft manufacturers operate a small truck service which delivers rivets at the proper temperature to the workers. Rivets are inserted while they're soft. When they expand at normal temperature, they harden and strengthen the plane structure. Other parts of the plane, particularly wing spars, which require large size rivets for additional strength, are stitched together by a squeeze riveter. One of the most ingenious developments of the aircraft makers is the explosive rivet. These tiny metal stitches are used only on blind surfaces where pressure cannot be brought to bear from both sides. Each rivet carries a small powder charge which is set off by a heated electric tool. Note how the rivets swell after they explode. Under the pressure of a speeded-up production program, aircraft workers are apt to become overtired, and this fatigue factor has caused serious concern among plane builders. Men working in cramped, uncomfortable positions have to slow down. Here is the production designer's answer to fatigue: a revolving jig which permits drillers and riveters to stand upright and work rapidly at a normal, comfortable position. In this minor subassembly, bulkheads are put together, then moved down the line to be riveted into the nose, center, and tail sections of the fuselage. Here, too, the bomber section is locked in a jig to ensure precision and accuracy. While many new machines have been developed in the rapidly expanding aircraft industry, the fixed and movable jig is of basic importance to assembly line production. More than 150 sizes of rivets go into each ship. Workers are instructed not to pick up dropped rivets because it wastes time. At night, machines pick up rivets, separate them from scrap material, then carry them to this machine which sorts them for further use. Each part of the plane is completed as nearly as possible before it joins a larger part. This light but strong crown section fits in the fuselage between the wings. Still another type of fixture holds the ribs of the fuselage firm while the workers put on the outer sheath of aluminum, the skin of the plane. The fuselage or body of the bomber has three major sections: the nose assembly, which houses instruments for the radio operator, the navigator, the pilot, co-pilot, and bombarder, then the center section, which must be built to carry a tremendous load of bombs, and finally, the fore and after tail section, which carries guns to fight off attacking planes. Into these sections must go the myriad parts which control the movements and fighting power of the bomber. All of them must be strong to withstand the terrific vibrations set up by air speeds of 350 to 400 miles an hour. Wing flaps must be light, yet strong enough to break the airspeed of the bomber while she's landing. Construction of the wing itself is just as complicated and important as the construction of the body. In a sense, it represents an even more painstaking effort on the part of aircraft designers. Streamlining and strength are all important. The smaller the wing surface, the faster the ship will fly. Then, too, as the size of the wing is reduced, the strain on its lifting power increases. So the wings have to be made stronger to hold the plane in the air. All these and many other factors are the problem of the plane designer. And the responsibility for executing his designs rests in the skill of these men. Together, they turn out planes guaranteed for maximum flight performance and safety.